Created a very safe place where you are not anonymous and integrity and transparency of information is paramount. We give you safety features baked right into the app. Out of over 18,000 users, we've only had to remove 3. I want you to think about who you would have looked up in the last week and why. How could this tool be helpful for you? Is it that new employee that you're thinking about bringing on to your tech startup? Is it that new babysitter that was just referred to you? Or maybe it's that person that you just looked up on Tinder and you're about to go out on a date. We have hit the media jackpot. We have spent no money on advertising and managed to get thousands of articles written about our company. We've been featured on Dr. Phil, Access Hollywood, TechCrunch, Entrepreneur.com, and we are so thrilled to be building our own Netflix documentary about the building of the People app. We have managed to gain partnerships that we are thrilled about. Google has agreed to do all of our marketing for a low monthly budget. We have gotten Amazon to agree with one of our monetization strategies and participate with us. And we've been able to get Mundo Media to help us with user acquisition at their own cost. Who are our competitors? I'm excited to say that we do have a competitor coming out in June of this year. They were supposed to launch a year ago. They're located in Australia and they're web-based. I don't know, they're a year behind development. Let's see what happens in June. We've had a huge success story in our category. Lulu was an app that allowed women to rate men, and men would have to pay what those women said about them. Lulu successfully exited the market on February 9th to the world's largest dating company called Badoo. Who's on our team? How are we going to carry this company to success across the finish line? Well, we're very tech heavy. We've managed to team up with a company called ThinkTech here in Calgary. All they do is build apps. They're currently iterating our app. We still have a relationship with Y Media Labs, who built our app in San Francisco. And our CTO, Chalam, is currently working at Salesforce while working with us. And what we're excited about is Chalam owns the patent to our product. So we brought him onto our team. He's built successful apps on Apple. We've also got Jeff Applin, who is the president of David Applin Recruiting, a $50 million recruiting firm across Canada. He is our other director. And then there's myself. I actually love where technology and people meet, and I have built a proprietary recruitment process that leads to a 96% successful placement rate at CareerFox, and I did that using technology. How are we going to make money? We're launching our first monetization strategy next month, where because people currently have full control over their profile in the People app, we want to give the users an upgrade where they can see all of the recommendations that never went live on their profile. We look forward to being profitable at month 15, and we also look forward to an $8 million revenue after 2 years and going global. We are looking for $2 million for 20% of our company. We have actually raised $443,000 for 17% of our company. The way we're going to win big is we plan on partnering with companies like VRBO, Airbnb, Uber, and eBay. These are companies that rely on your reputation to participate in their ecosystem. And we're excited to partner with them, go public, and then get bought. The market is huge. It's a 2 billion user market globally, but today we're focused on acquiring 8 million users in North America. We are so excited for you to join us on the People app today. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for the presentation. I've witnessed your media storm, and I think many other people in the room have also. I don't know if you were expecting that. There's one question that has been raised quite often, and I think you've answered it, but maybe for this audience. How do you make sure that this rating is real? Because all the other ratings you mentioned could be saying something that I'm not truthful.
Absolutely.
How do you solve actually the problem?
Absolutely. There's 4 actions that you can take with any of the recommendations you receive. You can publish them on your profile, you can delete them, you can block the user who wrote it, or you can report the user who wrote it. once the truth license goes live, you will be able to actually rebuttal on the back end your side of the story. And we are not forcing you to publish it on your profile. We are not publicly shaming you like Yelp does. So it's not our job to make sure that the information is actually accurate. This is user-generated content, but you will always have your say, and we will always protect you from users that are not appropriate. There's so many ways to break our terms and conditions, and unlike most tech companies, we will remove users, which is unheard of. We want to protect our community.
Test. All right. Thanks, Julia. So back to the Dr. Phil debacle. And you got some press for sure. Not all of it was positive. I'm wondering, some of the partnerships that you've proposed there are some pretty big, serious companies now that might, I'm just wondering how those talks have gone. Are they worried about tarnishing their image by associating, or is that long gone in their past?
They chose us because of that media attention. So Google every quarter chooses 12 companies that they believe on and believe in and that they want to invest in because of the virality, because of the amount of Google hits. We received 5 million Google hits when you search people. So Google wanted to be all over that, and they've agreed to take care of all of our advertising, all of our marketing. We get to work with their mobile team to develop all the future marketing of the People app. So that media helped us win. All of these companies approached us after the media storm because they were excited. They saw the same thing we saw, and they want to put their name on it. Thanks for your question, Rob.
With the revenue goals and growth, where's that revenue coming from?
How
do they monetize this?
Yeah, so there's 4 monetization strategies. The first one I mentioned was the Truth License, which we're launching next month. The second monetization strategy is in-app search credits. So once we gain enough traction, we'll be able to allow users to almost gamify the app, where they're earning search credits, they're spending them to search for people. And then 2 more monetization strategies. The third one is gifts, and that's the one that Amazon wants to participate in. So when you leave a recommendation for somebody, if you want to sweeten it, you can leave them an Amazon gift certificate, which is really exciting, a digital link. And we can gift that in so many different ways. It doesn't have to be limited to Amazon. And then the third monetization strategy allows us to, I apologize, I lost my train of thought here. Gifts, search credits, you're able to upgrade the app with the Truth License. And those are the monetization strategies. Yeah. Does that help answer your question?
I get the strategy, but how do you make money? So if you're referring to Amazon, you're getting a piece of the action, or how
Absolutely.
Does that work?
Okay. Yeah. So it's a revenue share model.
Right.
And our goal is to give, and we haven't set these numbers in stone yet, but we want to give Amazon 5% of the value of the gift certificate. So...
Amazon gives you 5% of the value that it gives
no,
you.
No. Yes, sorry. Yeah. I apologize. Okay. I'm like, wait a minute.
That's a pretty good deal.
You're like, wow, you guys are making money off of Amazon. Yes, we would like to keep 5% of the value.
Great.
Absolutely. And we've built financial models around these monetization strategies to get to these numbers.
What would you estimate your cost to acquire customers right now?
So we are not spending on advertising. And so that would be really hard for me to answer. I think that we've used the media to gain those users, but we do know that once we join up with Mundo Media and that partnership, they're going to be launching the campaign to help us acquire those users by proving to us that Mundo Media is the best to go with, and then we'll sign an exclusive contract with them. So their estimate is anywhere around $150 to $2 US to acquire one user. But we're only interested in the users, obviously, that are going to be spending, and we won't launch with Mundo until we monetize. Yeah. Thank you for your question.
So it's very bold, actually. When you put numbers like that, people are going to ask you. On the monthly active users, you see there's this curve that is kind of
Absolutely.
Flattening. In installs, I get it. What is the action that gets people back into your app? What is it that people engage with your app? Because you can create a large install base,
Great
but
question.
Why do people come back?
I can tell you right now that they're all coming back for a feature that we didn't expect to be this popular. It's called the nearby feature. So in the app, all of you guys, whoever's in this room that's using the app, can actually open it, hit the nearby feature, and see anybody in this room and within a 10-mile radius. So now you can network better. You can pinpoint anybody that you want to talk to, and it's more efficient for you. And that nearby feature seems to be one of the most it actually is the most popular feature. The second most popular feature is receiving recommendations. They're excited to see what people say about them. Thank you so much.
Can I have a question for you?
So next up, Randy Jones from Canary, who'll be talking to you about he'll basically explain to you how to build your business in the cloud. Big round of applause, guys. Before we start up, so I'm gonna be walking around the room after Randy's road talk to give out those feedback forms. We just wanna have your opinion, your feedback on there were different road talks and how we can improve on, and what would you like to hear our speakers, talk about next road talk. So once you fill it up, I'll pass on pens. If you can just return it at the registration booth, that'd be great. Okay, I'm counting on all of you guys. Thanks.
Hello. My name is Randy Jones. I'm with Canary. Canary is a Ottawa-based not-for-profit. Before I talk about Canary in the cloud a little bit here, can I show a, let's see a show of hands. How many people before today had heard of or knew anything about Canary? Wow. Okay, that's a lot more than last stop. You don't count, Lana. Canary supports research and education across Canada. We do that through a number of programs. One is we run a national backbone network that connects the regional networks and universities and research institutions. We also fund the development of research software. So if you're a researcher, you have a grant, rather than spending your money on developing custom software, you can apply to our programs to have funding for reusable software. And we are maintaining and curating a catalog of software that researchers can use free of charge for their projects. And we also support private sector innovation, and the program we'll talk a little bit about today is called DARE. It's a infrastructure as a service, cloud service. So if you're a software intensive company, you're a developer, you can use this free of charge for a year. So one other question for the audience. How many people in the audience today would identify as being a software developer or working with a software development team? Okay, yeah, it's about 40%, I would guess. Okay, great. Well, this talk is general about cloud. Some of it will be review for software developers, but there are a few insights that hopefully are helpful for you. To start, so probably don't need to tell this audience that our economy is changing from a resource-based economy to internet. So, basically moving to something that involves data and away from, milling, drilling, or killing things for a living. And, data is getting to be at the heart of just about all new solutions. And there's a lot of value in data, and Cisco, as an example, publishes an annual forecast, and they're suggesting that by 2019, a city of 1 million people will generate 180 petabytes a day of data from the Internet of Things and other devices. So this is a vast amount of data, and you know, I kind of like to think there's gold in that data, but you know, knowing where to look and how to extract it is really the skills we need. And you know, going through data, it can really help you sort of improve your product, understand how your customers are using it. You can mine data to improve your business processes and better target your marketing. And you know, there's lots of great tools now where you can, you know, pull data sets together, cleanse that data, join that data, and then, you know, run analytics on it to sort of segment or cluster that data, and then run predictive algorithms on it to forecast where things are going to be. So having these sorts of algorithms running on data in your solution is a really important thing these days. And companies that exploit data, studies have shown, generally have about a 4x revenue per employee to those ICT firms that do not. So if you are building a product, make sure you're paying attention to how you're acquiring data and using it to add value. So what are some of the technology trends behind this data acquisition, storage, and processing? Well, one is very dense, low-cost storage. So right now, as an example, you can get a gigabyte of data storage in Amazon's Elastic Block Store for 3 cents a month. And for long-term archival data, it even goes lower. You pay a cent per gigabyte per month. So, you know, having your own storage or on-premise storage really doesn't make a lot of sense anymore. I've done business cases on it, and it's about 10 times the cost to maintain your own on-premise storage than using storage in the cloud. Another trend is, you know, ubiquitous connectivity. We all have devices. We can access the internet from anywhere. And we use applications that are really helpful, like people, you know, just now. Like, it provides situational awareness so that you can access the data from anywhere and use it to drive your business and personal life. So underpinning all of this is really cloud computing. That's where all of these trends are coming together right now, and cloud is probably one of the largest transformational technologies going right now. So what can the cloud do for your business? Well, it really frees you to focus on your business rather than infrastructure. You know, I have worked for companies where a decade ago, when cloud was new, we built authentication authorization systems for mobile data service providers and very large systems, 70 million subscribers. But we spent probably 70% of our R&D budget just building out the infrastructure. And nowadays, you wouldn't need to spend any of that. You just lease your infrastructure from a cloud provider. So, you know, if you take away anything from today's talk, please don't set up or build your own infrastructure. Do not stick a server under your desk or try to repurpose an old laptop. It's really a waste of your time, because there's lots of free programs you can use to get access to cloud. All right, so this is where the software developers in the room tend to check out and look at their phones. Understanding some of the characteristics of cloud, you need a little bit of background on what it is and what the computing models are. So cloud is really on-demand compute, network, and storage resources that can be rapidly added and removed as needed. And one of the big innovations of cloud computing is that the resources are, you know, you only pay for what you use. So if you only use a server instance for an hour, you only pay for an hour. And likewise, I like to say the bad news about cloud is you pay for everything you use. And sometimes it's really hard to understand how much cloud resources you're going to use and understand what your cost base is. So we'll talk about that a little more. So what are the three main cloud computing models? So if building a software application is like building a house, then the cloud computing model known as infrastructure as a service is like the foundation. It's really the basic set of physical resources and virtualization software that allows a service provider to provide a multi-tenant environment for everyone to share. But like a foundation, it's not a full house, it's not a full application. So with infrastructure as a service, you need developers to integrate open source or commercial software packages. You need to write your own software. You need to build this up. So in a lot of ways, it's like the contractors you'd hire to build your house. Platform as a service builds on top of infrastructure as a service by providing pre-built reusable software modules, not unlike prefabricated housing components. So it allows you to build your application faster, but you have to pay for each one of these that you use. So whether you're concerned about time to market or cost, you know, you may want to consider infrastructure as a service versus platform as a service. And then finally, there's software as a service, and we're all probably familiar with that as users. So again, using the house analogy, rather than buying a house, you really just rent the house. And in the world of software as a service, you're just leasing the software for your use monthly. Okay, so why care about the models? Well, when you're developing your application, you need to look at platform services versus infrastructure services. So if you're really most concerned about time to market, you'd probably want to go use platform services because that allows you to get to market sooner. And probably your development costs will be lower because you'll be using less developer time. However, if that's not what you're concerned about, infrastructure as a service will actually be a lower service cost. So if your concerns are, once you've built your product, you've got it in production, and your concerns are service costs to the service provider, infrastructure as a service will be a lower sort of cost for you because you're not paying usage fees for each and every platform service. Like examples of platform services are, you know, a relational database as a service, load balancer as a service, messaging services. There's about 40 on Amazon's site of platform services that are great. I mean, it really makes building up an application fast and lower risk. But cumulatively, you pay for every one of these services, either directly or, in many cases where the services are free, they will consume additional compute network or storage resources, and you pay for those. And finally, there's vendor lock-in. So one of the bad things about the state of cloud today is that there are no real standards for platform services. So if you look at the big guys in the market, Amazon, Google, and Microsoft, they all have functionally equivalent platform services. But as you're working with them as developers, how you use those services is different. And there's not really a lot of portability between them. So when you start to use platform services, you're really locking into the vendor unless you're prepared to rewrite your code or re-architect your solution. And on that note, you may want to consider how your software team chooses what platform services they bring into the solution. As an example, let's say you've got a student working on your development team, and the student figures out that by using a platform service, they can shave 2 days off their project schedule. So that's a great thing that they're doing. It's good initiative, and it's going to save overall time. But that one decision that your student may have made in isolation could cost you thousands of dollars later on as you scale up in production. So even if you're not sort of the software developer or the architect or driving the product, pay attention to which platform services are being used and what the costs will look like when you're running in production at scale. Another aspect of vendor lock-in one needs to be concerned about relates to the elasticity of cloud. So when someone says elastic cloud, what they mean is a reference to horizontal scaling. So cloud computing has changed how computing scalability in computing goes. So before cloud, quite often scalability was done vertically. You'd have one big machine, you'd add more RAM, more CPUs, more disk, and eventually you couldn't buy a big enough machine. Cloud is different. It scales horizontally. It clusters many small compute instances almost infinitely. And the way it's done is through automation code, which is like a closed loop control system. So you look at the load on your solution. How busy is it? How many people are using it? And as you know, you get more load on your system, you add compute instances to your cluster. You scale horizontally. And that's a great way to handle, that's a great way to handle load as it arrives. But the problem is, if you let your system scale up and then the load subsides, you're going to be paying for all those instances, and it can really add up. So you need automation code to then offload or shed compute instances in your cluster. So the way this is done is through automation code, which uses programming interfaces on the cloud provider. So simple things like add a server or add an instance, remove a server, remove an instance. Those interfaces, again, are not standardized amongst the cloud providers. So as you invest in developing automation, again, you're investing in a given cloud provider. And if at a later time you want to switch cloud providers, it's going to be harder the more you've invested in any given provider's APIs. So what can you do to avoid lock-in? Frankly, I don't think it's possible. But you can minimize your costs in moving between providers. So use platform services by all means, but you know, be very, very selective about which ones you use. Design for code portability. Automate image synchronization. So an image is a snapshot of a server. So if you've got a server, a virtual server running in the cloud, and you say, okay, I want that exact server running in a different cloud provider, you take a snapshot of that. That's known as an image. You need to be able to move it out of the first cloud and into another. So, you know, invest in mechanisms for automating that, as well as for moving data sets from cloud provider to cloud provider. The other thing that's really important to understand is how your application consumes resources based on offered load. Because it looked like in March, people got a huge bump in usage. Huge bump. I bet it was totally unexpected.
Oh no, it was expected.
It was expected? Okay. All right. It's a fantastic number. But knowing how big that number is hard to predict, right? I think it was like 17,000 users in that range, something like that. But it could have been 170,000 or, right. You know, who knows? The problem is that would drive usage of your cloud. And the cost of that usage would really not be known unless you've sort of studied the relationship between offered load and resources. So profile that, because if you don't, you may not really understand what your costs are going to look like as things scale up and down. And that's important because the market is really evolving. The cloud market is changing, and in Canada recently it has really changed. So at Canary, we started the DARE cloud service in 2012, and we did it for two reasons. One was cloud adoption in Canada lagged other countries, and two, there wasn't a single cloud provider in Canada that guaranteed data sovereignty. So in other words, the data stays in Canada, it doesn't go down to the US or some other country. So that was 2012. If you fast forward now, we have lots of sort of native smaller cloud providers in Canada. And just in the last year, three large providers have come into Canada. So Microsoft in June announced, and they have two data centers up and running. I don't believe they're open for public use yet, but they're chasing like the government vertical, and they'll soon be opening this for public. DigitalOcean is a cost leader in the US, and they've opened a data center in Montreal. And they are actually a really economical cloud provider. They can provide a compute instance for $5 a month, which in the next slide you'll understand why that's interesting. And Amazon just in January announced a Canadian data center. So these big guys are coming into Canada, and that's going to create a whole new competitive dynamic and bring prices down, I think. We track the market at Canary, and what we've concluded is that right about now, you can buy a compute instance for around $57 Canadian a month. This is a normalized compute instance. That's one virtual CPU, 2 gigs of RAM, 40 gigs of storage, and up to 5 terabytes of data transfer. But we should expect that to come down significantly over the next 18 months to 2 years, and mainly because the technology used in cloud is not that different than what's in commodity web hosting services. And they can offer a hosted web service for, you know, $3 to $6 a month. Okay, so now I'm just going to introduce Canary's cloud service. Part of our mandate at Canary is to support private sector innovation. And so we created this cloud specifically for the small and medium business to develop, test, and do early commercialization work on our cloud free of charge for a year. And the eligibility to use this service, it's a cloud infrastructure as a service, is that you have an address in Canada and that you have less than 500 employees. So it's a very low hurdle. So you don't have to be incorporated. You can be a sole proprietor. In fact, about 85% of our applicants and users are less than 10 people in the company. And I really think a lot of them are, you know, 1, 2, and 3 people sized. So why would you use this service? Well, one of the big ones is it's free. You can avoid commercial costs in a public cloud of around $2,500 to $3,000 by using this cloud in the first year. We have no hidden costs whatsoever. Most cloud providers do grant free usage of their cloud, but there's a cap on that. And if you go over the cap, you're gonna pay. And I know lots of sad stories where developers got surprises at the end of the month where they left something running or someone found their site and downloaded a bunch of stuff out of it, and they suddenly were on the hook for a $500 bill. It's great also if you have no cloud experience and you want to just play with it and figure out what the key operations are. It's risk-free, really. And it's good performance. We have a data center in Edmonton and a data center in Sherbrooke, and they're connected across Canary's national backbone network, which is a 100 gigabit per second network. So it's a very high performance network with geographic redundancies if you want to test high availability schemes. And it's also a great place where you can, you know, build your minimum viable product and test it with early customers, get some market feedback. To date, we've had over 600 people apply and come through the program. We've got a very large body of case studies on our site at canary.ca/cloud/case studies. Check them out. There's a real diverse set of applications there, everything from forestry management products to mobile security products, healthcare products. It runs the whole gamut of things. And most of our users use the service specifically just to save money. And any money that they do have, any funding that they do have, they can put into other parts of their business rather than pay to a cloud provider. So what do you get with this service? What you get is four virtual, it's a quota, okay? And the quota is comprised of four virtual CPUs, four virtual machines, 8 gigabytes of RAM, about 80 gigabytes of block storage across up to four volumes, 200 gigabytes of object storage, so that's the equivalent of Amazon's S3. We provide operating system images. There's two variants of Linux. There's CentOS and Ubuntu. We also provide Windows server licenses, and we pay for those licenses if you wish to use Windows. Because we operate the network, there's never any bandwidth fees. There's no transfer fees, so you'll never pay for that. We provide support through email during business hours, and if this quota isn't enough, we will sell nominal quota to you for nominal. We'll sell additional quota for nominal fees, so you can double this free quota for $400 a year, which in a public cloud, again, that would be about $2,500 to $3,000. One of the things that we've listened to the development community that we're missing is graphic processor units. So if you're doing game development or like intensive visualization applications or also some data analytics, you need graphic processor units, physical chips. We're in the process of putting those in our data centers right now, and they'll be available this quarter. Signing up is simple. You go to canary.ca/cloud. There's a button there called labeled Apply to Dare. You click the button, you go to a form, you tell us who you are. We need your name, number, location, a brief description of what you're doing. We have an acceptable use policy that essentially you need to agree to so that you're not going to use our cloud for illegal or nefarious purposes. Or production use, so I want to make that clear too. So our cloud is for development test and early commercialization. That means you can run beta tests with your early lead customers, even paid beta tests, but it's not for volume production. If you've got 1 million subscribers and you're monetizing them, go to a commercial cloud provider. You can afford it. Leave this to the smaller companies that need help. After you filled out the form, we'll usually send you, if you're approved, we'll send you an email with access information within a business day, and then you can have a virtual server up and running within minutes and start your work. So I get a number of the same questions around DARE over and over again. So what happens after a year of free use? Well, our fondest hope is that you've succeeded in the market, you've moved on to a production, a public cloud for production, and we never see you again other than a happy thank you once in a while. But it takes, in many cases, longer than a year to develop your solution and the market. So if after a year you're not ready to move off, you can reapply to the program. If there's capacity in the cloud, you'll be granted a second year. Another question we often get is what's involved in moving off our cloud into another cloud? And for most developers that are familiar working with cloud, it's as simple as downloading an image out of our cloud, uploading it into a public cloud, and then creating an instance to run it on. So it's really something that's measured in hours of work for someone who's familiar with those procedures. As I mentioned, we provide email-based support during business hours. We'll usually respond within an hour. But this is where we differ from a public cloud provider. We don't provide a service level assurance that you know you'll get a call back within a certain period of time, 24/7. If you send us an email at 3 a.m. on a Saturday, you might not get you hear back from us until the Monday. And if you need more resources, you can buy them at nominal fees. As I mentioned, the quota can be doubled for $400. And that's it. Any questions? Wow, quiet. Oh, yeah.
You mentioned it's a not-for-profit. So you mentioned it's a not-for-profit. Can you tell us about the ownership structure of Canary? What is it? Is it the government?
Oh, yeah. So Canary is funded by Industry Canada, now known as Industry Science and Economic Development. It's a real mouthful. We also have members. We're member-driven, and members usually pay a small fee. So most of the universities that are connected into our National Research and Education Network pay a fee. We also have other programs and services where they're fee-based. So one of the programs we have is called the Canadian Access Federation. It's a federated identity management system, and we charge fees for participants in that as well. Canary's small. We got, I think, 32 employees, and all but one, I think, is Ottawa-based.
The mandate is only to provide this cloud service, or is there other services that you
provide? Well, the mandate is to support research and education, so that's a broad statement. And the programs that fulfill that are the backbone network that we operate. And that's been running since 1993, by the way. Initially, Canada lagged the rest of the world in adoption of the internet. And our network actually was the public internet backbone in Canada for a period of time. So we're kind of in the business of building digital infrastructure.
God, I grew up with a mic in my hand. It's hard to believe I couldn't get that one to work. I'm just like, this is not my space, but I've just heard recently that Google is really moving into the cloud service space and really competing with Amazon and some of the other providers out there. Are you aware, heard that, or what are your thoughts on that? Or I hear they're doing a load reduction model so that, you know, when you're not using it, you don't pay much for it.
Well, Google is one of the big three, but and apparently they have among the most advanced technology, because, I mean, that's how Google got to be Google. But they seem to be, my impression is they're lagging the other big providers in adapting their technology for public use. So they have had cloud technology for many years now, but from an infrastructure or platform as a service perspective, they haven't pushed it as hard, and it hasn't been embraced as much as, say, Amazon or Azure. Like, Google is trailing them in most of the reports. I think they're recognizing that there's a lot of money to be made here, and they need to either make it work or fall off.
I noticed you had GPUs on your roadmap. What about container services, managed containers, things like that? Is that on the roadmap?
Thank you. Yeah, so for those that don't know, the question relates to containers. So containers are a new type of virtualization technology. I wouldn't say new. They've been around for a long time, but they're very popular now. And the business benefit is they allow cloud providers to increase the workload density, so you can get more work done on a physical machine than if you're not using containers. They also have big benefits for software developers because they're faster to start. We support containers, for example, Docker. Docker is a very popular container engine, so you can integrate Docker into a virtual machine and then run your containers on that. But there's also a way of using containers known as on bare metal. So you have no hypervisor on the physical machine. There's no virtualization beyond the container engine. We don't do that today, but we are looking at it because In many ways, it has a lot of benefits beyond having a host operating system with a hypervisor and then guest operating systems on top of that. Any other questions? Okay, well, thank you very much for your time.
All right, so welcome back. And we're going to resume the pitches. It's going to be back-to-back pitches. And up next is Ben Block from Goes Around. Warm welcome of applause, guys.
Thanks. I'm Ben Block from Goes Around. I'm the founder and CEO. So what is Goes Around? How do you work a clicker? There we go. Goes Around is a social network designed to and software platform, rather, designed to allow individuals, businesses, and nonprofits to find, measure, and share their social impact activities. So we have Facebook for our personal lives, LinkedIn for our careers. Now we've got Goes Around for our community lives. Why do I think this time is right for this? Well, economic forces are developing online marketplaces in just about every vertical, Airbnb, Uber, etc. Volunteerism and socially responsible business is on the rise, and technology is teaching us to expect instant access to information and data on everything. But this hasn't yet reached the social impact world. That's what we're looking to fix. There we go. So to realize our vision, we've assembled feature sets for three distinct user groups. For individuals, we allow you to find impact opportunities that suit your interests, schedule, skills, and so on, track your contributions, and share those with your friends. For schools and nonprofits, we have a feature set that allows them to recruit volunteers, manage their programs, and better understand their own impact for things like grant applications and stakeholder reports. And finally, businesses. Many businesses operate complex CSR or corporate social responsibility programs, but lack the tools to fully engage their staff, understand the outcomes they're generating, and again, share those out into the marketplace and internally. So you're thinking, great, how do you make money off people doing things for free? So our CSR, corporate social responsibility platform, operates on a subscription basis. So typically large employers pay a subscription fee per employee to use our tools that I've said, better engage their staff in the programs they're very likely already doing, help track things like who they're helping, how much, what causes are being supported, and then share that internally for culture building and retention and externally for branding. Well, you can see some of the companies that I guess we're currently pitching. I've been watching my email like a hawk because I should hear from Avis and Young today. Second, our premium nonprofit platform. So we've got a free platform, and that's part of our social mission to allow nonprofits to find the people they need. But adding to that is our premium platform that allows them to better manage those efforts, so scheduling, messaging, and so on, and also deliver some metrics that they need, like who are our volunteers, what are they doing, how many hours have we generated, and so on. We just landed our first paying customer in that segment, a large high school in Edmonton, at $1,300 a year for 3 years. So in terms of market potential, we estimate a total annual market of $510 million. We think we're relatively reasonable in that because we've thought about things like what percentage of employers actually have CSR programs, how many people actually volunteer. We know everyone isn't our user, so who is? And then lastly, if we get to scale, what is a reasonable advertising revenue stream to anticipate off our probably closest parallel, LinkedIn? So like I say, we've tried to be realistic about our addressable market that we intend to attack in four channels. First, direct sales. Any enterprise B2B platform basically requires that. Social media has been our highest converting individual user source. And the nonprofits themselves have a very well-aligned group of followers that have been a good source for us in building our base. And then obviously search marketing is just what everybody does. In terms of competitors, there is no social impact social network, but that doesn't mean nobody competes with us. There are a number of internal HR sort of focused tools that mimic our corporate platform. There's also passive bulletin board like volunteer posting sites and of course existing social networks, but what nobody's doing is bringing together metrics management and networking layer in the way we are. A bit about our team. I'm an entrepreneur by nature and lawyer by training. I have business and law degrees from the University of Alberta. I practiced law for 4 years before leaving to focus on Goes Around, realizing I can't do both effectively. And unfortunately, the entrepreneurial bug has bit me well. My first business I started in university, it was a print and web design business. I grew it to $600,000 a year of sales. sold it to go practice law, but realized I'm an entrepreneur. Luckily, I have the support of a small but committed team of both technical and sales professionals and an advisory group in accounting, marketing, and the nonprofit sector. So far, we've attracted over 2,600 registered individuals and 280 nonprofits, and I'm proud to say a leading CSR consultant in the state sent an email to Nestle USA introducing us and calling us the next best competitor in the market. In terms of financials, we've raised just over $200,000 to date from friends, family, and an angel investor and a small National Research Council grant, but we're now in the process of raising another $750,000 to mature our platform, act on the market feedback we've received, and basically just grow the network. So that goes around. Happy to answer any questions.
Thanks for the presentation. Thanks for the detail at the end. Always like that. Just give me an example of a person coming into your platform and using it. Just a short little case study of how somebody uses it.
Sure. So from an individual perspective, you'll join, and it's much like joining any social network. You'll configure a profile, and in part of doing that, you'll tell me things like what causes are interesting to you, what sorts of tasks are interesting to you, what's your schedule like, because we're trying to make it easier for people to find ways to get involved. So instead of asking you to seek that out, now you'll immediately start to be served impact opportunities that fit your criteria. As you complete them, your contributions will be added to your profile, which you're free to share publicly or on your own resume or whatnot. And then it just basically progresses from there.
Excellent. And then Avis and Young would use that for their own employee engagement?
Right. So a lot of employers, for example, Avis and Young, they've got employee volunteer programs. They typically look like paid time off or dollars for doers, they'll call them. They'll give a financial contribution to the organization you volunteered with. But they have buy-in problems of people realizing these are available. How do I claim them? And then better yet, okay, we're paying for this, essentially. What are we actually accomplishing? So by connecting your individual profile, and this is an important distinction that you own, what distinguishes us from a lot of platforms is if you leave your employer, your track record's gone. Whereas this, it's think of it like LinkedIn, you just dissociate from Avis and Young and associate it to Cushman Wakefield. And now they start to capture the data while you're a part of their programs. And then out of that, they can evaluate and report on their own CSR activities.
Are there any government programs that might subsidize a company's purchase of your program or some of the hours that they book through this?
Just had a very productive meeting with the City of Edmonton, actually, on that point, that they were interested in possibly subsidizing the nonprofit platform to them, and out of kind of the carrot we can give the city is some sort of holistic metrics on sort of citizen engagement and volunteer hours and so on. So it's a bit of a evolving set of use cases, but that's a good one.
Are there competitors that do something similar? Like, are there, by the way, I love your logo and the name too.
But
is there something that's tracking, you know, fitness levels or something else by employees because they're trying to reduce healthcare costs and that sort of thing that would be similar enough that they could sort of branch into your space?
There are employee wellness programs, which is kind of the name for what you're talking about. And you're right, that actually some of them do sort of, as what I'd call an afterthought, include some of this volunteerism component. But what I think will make us truly bulletproof if we can realize on it is the network, because again, they would fall into what I call an internal tool, but the direct participation of nonprofits and your ownership of your own profile achieves a better buy-in and a more viable community than a wellness platform's ever going to.
Can you tell us more about the engagement so far with the platform? You said you have some users. Mm-hmm. Again, the question is, what do they usually do? So you create a profile. Mm-hmm. It's just sitting there. What do I do as a user? Why should I ever come back to your platform and engage with it?
As I alluded to, an important part of that profile creation is you're telling me or setting of your own criteria of what basically opportunities interest you, and then you'll come back when you receive a notification from us that, hey, you know, the local homeless shelter needs meals served tomorrow at 6. You said you're interested in physical tasks in the shelter sector. That might suit you. So you'll come back and submit your offer to help that, yeah, I'd be interested in that. So it draws you in that way. But in answering your question, a challenge for us is this like network component of this chicken and the egg. If there's no postings, you know, there's nothing to respond to. But if there's no responders, why post? So we've built in a few functions that are network independent. Like you can log your own volunteer hours that you might be doing elsewhere independent of us. So you're kind of building your track record. You can set a volunteer hour goal for the year, say, and it's got a little pie chart that shows where you are on your public profile. And then similarly for nonprofits, some of the management functions give us value until the network takes hold. But I don't know if that fully answers your what do I do next question, but that's basically it. Sure.
Sorry, I have a two-part question. So one, I think what you're doing is really cool. Can you speak a little bit about, it sounds like you're almost creating a bit of like a clout score, like almost like an algorithm for someone's activity in the socially good space?
That's exactly the direction we want to go, is we're working on, and our brainchild at the back came up with this sort of index we're essentially trying to develop out of things like that rate your participation and your satisfaction of your goals, and then but also gives you a fit metric on matching you to opportunities. So, you know, skills-based volunteering is a very popular thing, particularly in the corporate sector. How can we incorporate that into the matching algorithm, essentially to make it as meaningful as possible, right, to find something you actually want to get off the couch and do?
Right. So on that, in terms of the actual algorithm, how are you guys measuring? Because it's the whole thing that you're doing is you're giving a company transparency through quantitative metrics as to how engaged their employees are. So what are you... Can you talk a little bit about that itself, the actual tool?
I'm terrible with this. Can you hear me if I just talk? So some of the metrics we imagine, it's beginning to evolve as we're working with companies to see what they actually care about, but things like percentage of employee engagement, you know, how many are actually signed up for the platform, how many have used it, tenure segmenting, so are your new guys the only ones who are using it, or is it the old guard who are out in the community, and functional departments, that kind of thing, skills-based stuff like we've talked about. So those, I could give you a kind of a lengthy list of the various reports that we can run now, but it's continuing to evolve based on feedback.
Which is great too, because every year big corporations are looking at where their, you know, marketing dollars are best being spent. So if they're getting a lot of engagement for $50,000 sponsorship of an event, then they know that it's probably worth doing again. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, and one last thing, for social entrepreneurs, those who actually have a business that has an ingrained, embedded social mission into it, how are you going to cater to that? Because I see several different segments. I see the big corporates, and then I see just like individuals. But for a social entrepreneur, are you going to create some sort of a separate way to measure their impact so they can report that to investors or shareholders?
The tools are completely accessible to anyone. The challenge, if that's the right word, that I found in figuring out who our ideal user is the very small company. Tends to plan this stuff around a table and doesn't necessarily need a metric tool to scoop it. That doesn't mean you can't. We certainly have a small business account that's $20 a month plus $1 per employee, so it's available, but my experience is it pretty much takes 200 plus employees before they start to see the real value in the data to pay for it.
Yeah. One last question. I see a good integration with people, you know, good job on that. I like the idea. Have you looked at schools? Because schools look for volunteers all the time, and you know, this is a good tool for the schools.
That's actually who our first paying nonprofit customer is a school, and just got an email from them before I walked up saying that they'd like to bring in a few others because they're interested in the concept. So you're correct.
So last question.
On the premium platform, are you available or have you thought of co-branding or white labeling options for the corporates?
Yeah, that's actually something we're going to do. In conversations with some of the corporate users we're pitching now is that exact thing, is we want it to look like us. And even actually, the gentleman's comment on the schools, it's a common desire to want their sort of white labeled branded access portal that they can tailor what's readily available, so corporate programs, school programs, whatever, but then that the user could theoretically take that same account, go to goesaround.com and use it more widely. So long answer to say yes.
Up next, Hoblet. It's the forms for those who of you who asked. And we have more pen if you guys need any pen to fill out the form. Thank you.
Check, check. So I just don't touch this button. All right. Hi, everyone. I'm Sam, founder of Hoblet. At Hoblet, we connect local experts to people who want to learn from them. Hoblet started last year when I realized I sucked at photography. And I wanted to learn more, and the only places I could find to learn photography were institutions like U of C and SAIT. They were charging upwards of $1,000, they offered a diploma, and wanted a 3-week commitment. I just wanted to learn photography in 2 hours by contacting a professional. So I went to Kijiji, out of all places, and I found a professional photographer who agreed to take me out and show me how to shoot the city with as many people as I wanted to bring. So we split the costs, and that's where the idea really came from. So I set out to start a platform with two assumptions. The first one being that people who are passionate about what they want to do, they love sharing. Think of that enthusiast you spoke to last week. It was probably hard to get out of a conversation with them. They just keep talking and talking. The next assumption I made was people are looking for unique experiences. Think of Airbnb. Why do people use Airbnb? Yes, it's a bit cheaper, but really it's about that experience you create when you meet new people, when you immerse yourself in that culture. It's really about the experience. So we set out and created this experience platform. You can find things to do in this city. You can look for things you want to do. We have woodworking classes, metalworking classes, pottery, anything, you name it. You can book, find a schedule, and then pay. Three simple steps, and you're doing something completely new that you never thought you'd want to do. What we're finding is, on the opposite end of the token, if you want to teach a class or host a class, we offer an end-to-end solution for marketing, scheduling, and monetization. And with our streamlined experience, you can host a class in less than a minute. What excites me the most about this platform is to see how creative people are getting with it. So Dan over here, he's an engineer by training. He's a park ranger volunteer, and he's a photographer as a hobbyist. He's taking people to Canmore to show them landscape photography. Colin Pischke, just yesterday, he taught a 3D printing class in this room to 60 seniors. He made $400 in that 1 hour he taught. It was an amazing experience for both of us. That was our biggest event we ran. He never would have met these seniors had it not been through Hoblet. Right now, the opportunity, we have 350 active users, half of which have converted to paid customers. The market we work in is the shared economy, the peer-to-peer market. It's worth $26 billion, same market as Airbnb and Uber. We're growing at 100 users a month, and our hosts are extremely happy with our services because they're making at least $100 an hour. How does the model work? So starting down here, anyone who wants to teach a class can post in less than a minute. People who are looking for things, such as you guys, go onto our website, you look for something you want to do, you book it, and you pay, you're done. How do we make money? We charge $1 for every person who's finding a class and booking, and we charge 10% for all the hosts, only after we find people for their class. Experts walk away with 90% of the money they ask for. Another thing we're approaching, we're seeing a lot of opportunity in the white label market. Because we don't have enough time, I'm not going to cover that, but that's something we're really focusing on now. How our go-to-market strategy right now, we have 9,000 combined followers on Instagram and Twitter, 2% conversion rate. So we're doing really good on the social media front. We just started working on Kijiji and Meetup.com. We're seeing 100 unique users coming onto our site from these. 50% of them are actually paying. In terms of partnerships, what we're realizing is that travel companies are looking for local experiences now. They're not looking to offer tourist experiences. And we're talking Travel Alberta, Airbnb, and Expedia. So our progress so far. Last year, we started in May. I shape-shifted cardboard duct tape, made a really bad MVP. I tested it, picked up the phone, and made everything kind of... All my interactions were via the phone, and the website just served as an idea. In January and February, we closed down the website. We took everything we learned, and we relaunched in March. And now we're at 360 users with 180 transactions. Our competitors don't really have similar competitors right now, but we're looking at Kijiji, Groupon, Eventbrite, and Meetup. These sites are not good for hosting experiences or finding experiences. We are all these sites combined. So far, in terms of our finances, we're 100% bootstrapped, and everything we've done today has been with less than $2,000. How do we do it? This is our team. They're an incredible group of people, none of them of which are here today. We all have tech startup experience, and we're very lean. We only build features we need, and we build features, and we test them, and we test them, and we test them. And that's Hoblet. Thank you for listening.
A question about the experiences. Any ideas if it's going to be more around lifestyle experiences versus something that's more technical based?
Yeah, so right now we're remaining agnostic. So we have people who are doing experiences that are more teaching, so learning. And then I like the lifestyle market because I imagine that one day if, just say we're in Japan, we can have someone teaching you how to make knives. So I want to focus it on lifestyle, but in terms of the teaching market, that's where we're growing the most. So again, we're remaining agnostic for now, and we're going to pivot to whatever gives us more traction.
Thanks. Thank you.
Seriously. Check.
Thank you. Sorry. A good presentation, although I assume you're looking for money, and I don't know how much or what that means. So obviously, a question from a funder.
Yeah. So we are looking for money, but ever since walking into this white label platforming and pricing us at $100 a month, we might be able to get enough pre-orders to just feed ourselves Domino's pizzas and just keep going. And right now I want to continue with our team and just bootstrap all the way until we get enough value for our equity.
Given the size of your team and the amount you spent so far, what does your capital structure look like? Because you must be—they're either getting paid or they're getting promises. I'm just curious how that's working.
So everyone's going to be paid in cash right now. Equity hasn't been discussed. We're talking. So the team is large because they're basically people I've rallied together over the 1 year time we've been building. The developers. They're on board only after I've found exactly what we need. So they work 6 hours a week. They don't really work too much, but they're part of the team because we work very well together. So the way we're working it is when we do get funding, the developers get paid first, and that's when the tech starts scaling up. But so right now the team's a bit bigger than we need it.
So you're saying your cost to date has been $2,000 Canadian, but you haven't calculated the cost to date of the people, the time that they have put in. Going to do that at the future, at the round of the future?
We haven't talked about how much cash people are earning when we get seated. It's people are going to get paid when we do get money.
Our cost of hours is cost of hours, so it's not $2,000 to date.
Okay. Yeah. If I haven't calculated that then. But it's not, on the developer side, it hasn't been very developer heavy. We've really focused on building the business. As much as I like to say we're a tech company, we're more of a services company. So what's more important there is just building the relationships with our vendors. And that's what we've really focused on. So most of the hours have been from myself.
I guess not quite a question, but I would recommend locking down equity, payment, what you owe people now, mm-hmm. because if this starts taking off, this will all become huge liabilities.
Yeah.
Just a recommendation.
Thank you. We're always looking for advice. What I love about the team right now is we know we don't know, so we're always looking for advisors, people to talk to. Thanks for the advice. Yeah, the mute button's hard to
work. I'd like to congratulate you on the platform there. Actually, love it.
Thank you.
I just had a question. I do use Everbrite right now. So the application, what I would use this for, and I understand that the Airbnb, they did a great job on how they presented their real life experience and how they presented themselves. So if I want to do a course on that, does it have to be photography related or any subject?
So the idea is anyone who's passionate about what they want to do, they can teach a course.
Okay.
So we have cooking classes, woodworking classes, anybody in the city who wants to do something, you'll be able to find.
Okay. And is it and then we also do courses on webinars, things like that. Do you have a video application on there?
No, we want to keep it local. So one of my frustrations with YouTube is anytime I pick up a new hobby, I'm on YouTube to learn everything. But I always have one burning question that never gets answered. And I'm sifting through 500 videos, and I still have that one question. I just want to talk to somebody who's done it.
Okay. If I put a course on there, then you help find people that's related to the same thing, and then they buy the three steps or whatever. Then how long is the course for that type of money? Do I set the cost, or you set the cost, or is it a set cost for the course? Or
whoever the host is will set the cost at their schedule.
Okay.
And you just click what time you're available, and you meet up.
At a location or here? Or
wherever they set. So Airbnb concept, you can go to their home for like pottery.
Right.
A lot of artists have pottery wheels at home, and they have their own little studio. And they can have three people come over and learn pottery.
Okay. What's the payout on when you pay? Who handles the cash?
Stripe does right now, which is
us. Stripe does? Okay. All right.
Thank you.
So the next startup pitch is QWave. Adam will be presenting. So big round of applause for Adam. Thank you.
Hello. All right. Thank you for the introduction. All right. I'm delighted to be here. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Adam Keeling. I am the CEO of QWave. Now, QWave actually started out as a hearing aid company, but we soon realized to our amazement that a third of customers were actually hunters, spending thousands of dollars on hearing aids, trying to get an edge in hunting by enhancing their hearing. This gave us a very unique insight into this niche market for a very new innovative solution. QWave's wearable is like a smart earplug for hunters. Not only does it provide them with the superhuman hearing that they've always been looking for, but also includes environmental and biometric sensors to provide features such as GPS tracking, body vitals monitoring, and even long-range shooting ballistics. These are just a few of the over 50 features and enhancements. But before starting this project, we wanted to take the time to have a deep dive market assessment done by a third-party firm. We wanted to understand the level of market demand, the minimum viable product, and price sensitivity, among other insights. We were all surprised to learn just how enthusiastic this group is for their sport, and just how perfectly our product feeds into this customer's psychology, fueling their pride of being the best hunter with the best skill-enhancing accessories. In just the first 36 hours, they had over 250 hunters sign up to take the survey to hear about this new wearable. Of them, 96 signed up to be notified as soon as they can purchase pre-sales. 20% of them told us they wanted it right now. I don't care what it costs. Give it to me. And the next 42% wanted it for more than double of what we were originally going to price it at. Now, in the first few years, with a market penetration of 0.01% to 0.3%. We're projecting net profits of $5 million in year two, $14.8 million in year three, and over $28 million by year three, or four, sorry. Now, by reaching out to just those who signed up in those first 36 hours, this is over $215,000 in possible sales. But these projections are just for the hunting market. Because of our patent-pending platform, our ability to enter additional markets is made easy. No hardware changes or redesigns are needed, just a simple software app. Our conversations with Lockheed Martin has shown us that there's great interest in use for military applications. And the list of partnerships in other markets is extensive, from medical, including hearing aids, to fitness and coaching, to construction. We're currently building our prototype with the help of ACAMP and with the help of George Lucas's THX audio team. And just recently, we were approached by 500 startups by one of their venture partners, who happens to be an avid hunter and wears hearing aids. He heard what we were creating and asked us to join their incubator down in Silicon Valley. This strategic partnership will leverage 500 startups' knowledge and large network to create a professional Kickstarter campaign for the first ever hunting device on Kickstarter. But our focus of our Kickstarter campaign is not the equity, but rather as a large PR and marketing campaign to drive awareness and pre-sales. We are raising $200,000 to match the $542,000 we already have lined up in grants and seed investment from 500 startups. So now you may be asking yourself, why are we the perfect team to bring hearables to the hunting market? Pauline and Erica have over 18 years of combined marketing experience. I have a master's in electrical engineering from Germany with over 10 years of managing engineering teams. Sorry. And together, we know the competitive landscape. We understand our customers' demands from our unique insight, and we know how to build scalable systems. We're supported by our team of advisors with backgrounds in scaling and selling companies. Andreas Weissman has over 15 years of biotech and medical startup experience. Ray DePaul, an A100 member and VA angel, with a track record of leading an exit with Intel and is one of the key members that brought BlackBerry to the world. And Lori Fincham, whose distinguished 60-year background in designing some of the most iconic speakers has garnered him several industry awards, including the prestigious Audio Engineering Society Award. This is our team, and these are our partners. Together, we are going to revolutionize this exclusive niche market. I promise you, KeyWave will become a major player in the hearable space. We have the team, we have the solution, and we have the demand. And now I want your help in adding fuel to this fire. Thank you very much.
It went by pretty quick. What are you raising again in valuation?
So our valuation's at $750,000, and we're raising $200,000 in exchange for 21% of the company. Those funds, which I have a bunch of supplementary slides here, will be, sorry. So these are some of the grants that we already have lined up. So this is what that $200,000 will be used for. And the overall $742,000, this is the design phase. So where that fits into our roadshow is right about here. So the 200 plus the 150 of the future, taking us right through, and possibly a future $150,000 milestone.
Great presentation, Adam. I would like to know about more about where you're at with your prototype, and especially you mentioned the patents. How far along do you know that you're at?
So we are actually just about to start our alpha prototype. We're already done our proof of concept, and this money is to actually cover the grants, the contribution side, to start all the alpha prototype stages. And you asked about our patent. So we actually went out and we hired two patent agencies to do real deep dives into this to figure out, okay, what can we patent? So with the first technology of the biosensors, we had 16 million different patents that was using that. And then as we added each area of our full product, it actually got down to zero. Even at three, our patent guys mentioned that usually they deal with 20 to 30 patents that they have to dig through. Once we hit zero, yeah, they all kind of noticed us right away and told us exactly what we should be doing. So we got in touch with SMEs, electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, and even physicians to actually help us design our patent before we filed it. So you filed it? Yes, it is filed, yeah.
Looking 5 years out, is there any sort of intersection with some of the new AR technologies or VR technologies like Magic Leap, Oculus, et cetera?
Yes, actually, you touched on one of the areas that one of the companies that reached out to us was Microsoft for HoloLens, sorry. And they were interested in the, because we have a 9-axis accelerometer in it, and incorporating it into their technology. Now, we're a little bit behind. If we were completed our alpha prototype, we would like to continue those conversations. And it's actually like that with quite a few companies, the ones that I somewhat listed here, that as soon as we have our alpha prototype, yeah, they want to continue conversations with us.
Yeah, hi, great presentation.
Thank
you. Two-part question. What's the average battery life? Because I gather it's battery powered.
6 to 8 hours.
Okay, and second question, have you thought of alternate uses like incorporating Bluetooth into the earpiece?
It does have Bluetooth, yes. It has Bluetooth 4.2. So it actually, the device has 15 sensors, micro and nano sensors within the device. And it feeds that down to your smartphone. And from there, it's all just a data augmentation. So you're just using software. But yeah, it feeds it through Bluetooth. Yep. The only thing that it actually processes, so one of our partners is actually Intel. They're actually giving us some chips that aren't even out on the market yet. The Curry chip for wearables. They heard what we were creating. We talked with them. And they're actually giving us some of their demo prototypes so we can at least start building our alpha prototype. And with that, it'll just process the audio side of things. Everything else has been sent down to the phone.
So you've done your homework in terms of the market needing this or wanting this. How are you going to go to market? Are you thinking of licensing? Are you thinking of manufacturing? Are you thinking of going down the full path?
We're thinking of actually going down the full path. So we had originally thought about doing white labels. We thought about licensing technologies, but as we those board of advisors are just a few of the actual people that we do have on board. And as we talk to everybody to get their point of view, we decide we got to go down the full path to really make it worthwhile. And our sales channel, which I think you kind of alluded on, is we're looking at doing big box realtors. So for the hunting market to start, we're talking with Cabela's and Bass Pro, and then we're also going to offer it online. But that being said, once the customer owns the product, then our SaaS revenue model comes into effect. So we'll give them the basic features and enhancements, but we'll continue to evolve and build new and greater features and charge, you know, a one-time fee of maybe 99 cents up to $9, depending on the feature. Oh, okay. Anybody in the audience? I think you have.
We're good to go, okay. Quick question about the hunting side of things. What have you done to allow communication in areas that don't have Wi-Fi signals for hunters to communicate to each other?
So we'll be actually incorporating your cell phone into that, almost like the WhatsApp app. So within that, we'll actually allow two-way communication. This is where military got very interested in this. So you can have, instead of carrying your two-way radio, it's already incorporated into your phone through the app and then right to the device. So it's just push to talk for your communication-wise.
Have you found any opinions on, you know, as a hunter is set to aim, releasing one hand off his bow, for example, to push to talk on his ear when he's scoping in on an animal. Is there a way to get around that?
For sure. Like I say, the hardware is the platform. It's all software based. And we were actually thinking of opening it up to other software developers to build apps around the actual product itself. So yeah, the limits are
unlimited, essentially, just whatever you can think of. But that is definitely an option we can add to the list. I take it you're a hunter? Yeah? Well, great point. I'm going to add that one to my list. We'll look into that one.
All right. Sure. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Next, we have Pei James will be pitching.
Hello. Everybody looks tired here. I'm Colin Bimson, co-founder of Pei, along with James and Henry here. Pei is a registered money service business in Canada. We've been established in 2005. What's the opportunity? 47% of the world's card fraud occurs in the United States. So, fairly large number. Guess what? $16 billion in fraud losses by banks and merchants worldwide. Some really big numbers here. In Canada, $300 million. In the US, $7 billion. A lot of this is happening, and it's impacting the government. Obama's decided to crack down on that, and that's impacting our entire market. In terms of card fraud, it's impacting Canadians by $5 to $7 billion a year. So it's a very, very large number. So we have three trends within our marketplace that are impacting our business as well as our growth. That's e-commerce, money remittance, and the overall growth of the internet. Currently, there's e-commerce sales in Canada of $25 billion. Potentially in 2019, that's gonna be $50 billion. E-commerce sales overall, we're anticipating a $28 trillion size in the market. So absolutely very large numbers. We also have money remittance. Canadians remit $30 billion a year. Growth of the internet, 3 billion people have the internet right now, anticipating 20 billion by 2020. So what's our solution? The world's first all-in-one global e-payments platform. Merchants accept e-payments from online mobile websites. That includes Bitcoin bank transfer. We're adding in credit cards and Interact. Within our system, it's an international peer-to-peer money transfer system right now, so you could send money to 60 different countries throughout the world. We also have currency exchange within our system, multiple currencies in multiple countries. We also have world-class security within our system. Everything is all about saving time and money for the consumers and the merchants in this world. How do we make money? Credit card processing fees, recurring revenue is what we get. Money remittance, our fees are $2 to $10 right now. We're cheaper than a lot of companies out there. Number three, currency exchange. It's set at 2.5% right now in the system, and e-payment integrations. You as a business owner, if you want to put the pay button on a website, it's $25 right now. Impact is one merchant processing $1 million per year, we get about $5,800 in revenue. 95% gross margin, 100 merchants to us is $580,000 in revenue. Our gross margin per merchant is about 76% plus. How are we going to market? Search engine optimization, Google AdWords, social. We have some other brands that are online right now. We've marketed in Canada and the United States under different brands. Altogether, over the past year, we've brought in about $500 million in merchant dollar processing volume that we're about to get underway on our business. Channel partnerships, e-commerce platforms. We're trying to work with Magento, WordPress. We're trying to work with get our system in AutoTrader, Kijiji, online marketplaces like that. We also have an affiliate program. If you sign up for the affiliate program, you get 30% from our revenue. We're launching a massive viral e-marketing campaign. $10 will be you'll be receiving as a consumer and $20 to a merchant. Right now, our existing system has 1,700 registered users, and based on that, we expect to grow our user base to over 100,000 users. Competition. We have a lot of competitors within the space, but not everybody's doing what we're doing. Team, myself, I'm from Toronto, James is from Calgary, Henry's from Vancouver. We also have Joe Forzani from the Forzani Group Limited, certified business coach that's been helping us out. He's from Calgary. Luis Kizis from Toronto. He's on BNN business, has been on BNN Business News Network. Projections: 29 million over the next few years. Very conservative, based on acquiring 1,000 merchants plus. In terms of traction, 1,700 users. Right now, in the past, we've processed over $100,000 in payments. We have global users, mostly European. Milestones, we're Canadian, we're also US incorporated. We have a minimum viable product right now. We've rebranded from the original brand, which was Cash Center to Pay. We partner with a US company called Vantiv. We are working on channel partnerships to expand our business in Cambodia and the United States, as well as multi-layered encrypted security within our system right now. Our future development, we're going to add in credit card processing to increase our sales. We're going to add in bank verification. We're going to add in verified ID verification, as well as real-time verification, so our system is completely bulletproof. Opportunity, investment opportunity. We got 150K in our business right now. We did some sweat equity like most of you have done. We haven't approached any angels at this moment in time, no grant money as well. We're asking for 400K for 20% of our company ROI within the first year. Use of funds to add in credit card processing, some marketing, licensing in the United States, fraud management and cybersecurity. Thank you. Please sign up.
So I'd be happy to field any questions from the panel or the audience.
Thanks for the presentation. Just tell me what makes you different than other payment providers out there.
Well, the thing really is about security, right? I started development on this in 2005. It launched in 2010. The whole reason was because of I was concerned that my account with another major competitor had serious security flaws. So I built a system that had major, major, major security enhancements that even today none of the other websites have. So if you're really concerned about your online security, our website, as far as I am concerned, is probably the most secure for your data that's out there. So we really allow you to lock down your personal information. Nobody can access your account other than you at your home, in your office, at your desk. And that's really this, you know, there's many other security things we're adding, but that's the meat and potatoes. So because we're more secure, we reduce fraud, we can have lower fees, we have lower costs, and we pass that on to you in the way of lower fees.
The merchant pays the fees generally.
Lower fees, though. Lower fees than what our competitors are charging because they have less fraud.
So in your presentation you mentioned that you're expanding to the US, Cambodia, most of your user base is in Europe.
Yes.
Canada being your base,
right?
So is that been driven by the users? Is it driven by your partnerships? What is driving you in this multiple country expansion?
Yeah. So as I say, I have other businesses, and all of my clients are based in Europe. So hence the user, but the 100,000 that we've processed so far is mostly through my other businesses that are using the service. Okay, we can't access the U.S. market without venture capital because that's very expensive. So we need this capital to start to register as a money transmitter in key U.S. states, and we need to add credit cards. We need to become an ISO MSP so that we can process Visa and MasterCard in the same fashion as the 4 million-pound gorillas out there. So we need $200,000 to $400,000. Minimum of 250 to really get that going, and that's what we need the venture capital for.
So all your current account base, all the current customer base is based on current on your network. It hasn't been through a marketing acquisition funnel.
Exactly. So basically, Colin and James have partnered with me as of the end of last year, because I needed partners and capital to take it to the level that we're presenting to you today.
So do you have any patents on the security stuff you're talking about?
Well, how about?
Oh, hi. Oh, hi. Yeah, sorry. I should mention that me and Colin actually, Michael Witt is actually our lawyer with Bennett Jones, is the director of Innovate Calgary. He actually filed our patents. We filed about 50 patents in mobile payments, payment processing, online payments, payment authentication, process flow, anything to do with ATM machines, and a bunch of other Bitcoin patents. So we actually do have about 50 patents that we have filed with the U.S. Patent Office. Yes. So just to answer your question, yeah, there is some sort of patents on the system.
So you said you launched your product in 2010? That's what this gentleman
said
here?
Yeah, that's when I launched Cash Sender. That's correct.
Okay. And it took you 5 years to get $100,000 through your system?
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah, because I didn't have venture capital, I didn't have credit cards. Basically, what I created was a low-cost online payment system that was bank account source payments.
And that was at how many users?
There's 1,700.
Creating the $100,000.
There are 1,700 users that are signed up, and probably a couple hundred of them.
A couple hundred are active?
Yeah, that generated the $100,000 worth of payments.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other questions? All right, well, thank you so much.
Hey, you're welcome.
So up next, we have Higher Ground, and Marilyn will be presenting today. Warm welcome of applause.
This is a tough crowd, isn't it? A little bit like The Voice. Okay. So I'm Marilyn Kelman, the CEO and president of Higher Ground Software. We're here, Calgary-based. And we primarily work with applicant tracking software. So can you hear me? Perfect. I can always just speak. I've got a loud voice. However, I'll qualify. I'm on contact C, so it's probably a little mutey right now. So we primarily work in the space of applicant tracking software. Is that too loud for people? No? Good. That software manages career portals for company corporate websites. We cross industries. We're, of course, heavy here in oil and gas. Where's my little button here? There we go. So we applicant tracking corporate websites is our key business. Something that we were really, really concerned with was parsing technologies. And I don't know how many of you have heard of that particular industry term, but what it is basically is it takes any doc, any PDF, any document that you would normally get in resume data, converts it to text, and then it starts to analyze that document. And so we can now start to pull data out of that, and that is, I believe, going to be one of our strengths in moving forward with our product. We previously had tried to address that issue using the four suppliers that are out of the US, and they could not meet our needs. So hence we moved to developing and building our own. So it supplements, of course, our applicant tracking. I'm gonna have to go through this fast, I know, because I'm not prepared for 7-minute presentations. The average job list sees roughly 250 applications. That's 250 pieces of resume information, plus. document uploads, questions, et cetera, et cetera. Right now in this industry in Alberta, they're seeing about 1,500. So if you can imagine hand reading 1,500 pieces of document and information, you can't possibly do it. So there's got to be faster, quicker, better ways of doing that. And that's what we're trying to address, of course, combined with our applicant tracking system and our parsing technology. The market for HR software in the US was in 2014 was $1.5 billion. That's again US dollars. And the worldwide market, $10.4 billion. So, and that was in 2013 figures. So it's a big market for HR software. Of course, that's HR software in general. You're not breaking down just the applicant tracking piece, but it's a huge market. In our space, there are only four of us that are providing applicant tracking software in Canada. So we're one of four. We hold currently 500,000 of that business, and I can answer questions as to why we only hold 500,000 of that after. We expect this year a moderate 20% or plus growth, of course, due to the economy. Of that parsing technology, however, down there, there are four US providers. There's no Canadian providers. So we would be the only provider of that parsing technology in Canada. In terms of development, we're mid-development of an entire applicant tracking system, hence our revenue down. And this is not a small system. These systems are big. This is not an app. This is an entire database structure built, and it's a fairly comprehensive system, takes years to build. And we've unfortunately found that out. We've got an older legacy system that holds a good percentage of our client. We've decided because we wanted to be ahead of the game, we would rebuild the entire system. So hence, we're rebuilding the entire system on current technologies, and then we've also at the same time, in alignment with that, been developing our parsing tools as well. So we I think, are, to our knowledge, the only provider of both applicant tracking and parsing. We're the only provider that owns both of those. We service, of course, Canada, some of US, but we're not prone to the US Privacy Act, which is a big leg up for us. It's a huge advantage. Our business model, we can sell, of course, SaaS. We're all SaaS-based, so we can sell to any industry, any size. We're currently, because of the status of our, or the build of our system, we're currently focusing on clients that are roughly 200 to 7,000 employee bases. That's roughly where we are now. That will change as we progress, and by year end we'll likely be enterprise level. So we'll be able to approach the larger client, the worldwide entity with multiple business units. Pricing model is a per user per month model, and I mentioned SaaS. Attrition rate's about 10%. We really look after our clients. So attrition rate is low for us as compared to the industry standard. Because we look after our clients, we're building new technologies and we own some of that parsing and some of the other things, we see a far less reduction rate in our client base. And of course, our objective is to grow. We're at the stage now where we can grow, where we've developed and learned and, you know, been there and done it. to market our product, we spend a lot of time at the HR events in Canada. We're going to do the typical social media marketing, the email, letters, types of things. Partner channels are important to us, and we're currently working now in building a partner channel, actually, with Workopolis and CGI. They'll likely be testing our parsing technology. Workopolis will likely also look to us as their new provider of their ATS. They're currently using a US provider, and they're not really happy with their US provider. Again, dollars are a big deal in this. A lot of the US providers now are outpriced. A lot of our Canadian people are starting to shop us for that reason. Next focus is on new markets. We're looking at Australia, New Zealand, UK. The US market is populated. So we do not, unless we see a particular sector in there, we probably will not spend a whole lot of time in the U.S., possibly with the only exception of the Western Seaboard. Current competition, Taleo, biggest one, owned by Oracle now. They were just purchased. They hold 54%, 15 years old. And I think what I'm trying to point out here, and I won't go through all of these, is all of these providers are really old. They're getting past their due date in terms of capability and function and providing a good system. The only exception to that is Workday at the bottom, which I don't know how many of you have heard about Workday, but they're hot in the market, they're coming out, they're moving fast, they've got a good product, and they're taking market share. But I would say with the exception of them, everyone else is going to be losing market share in the not so distant future, and we're hoping to be part of that game. We have a staff of 10 to 12. Most of our staff have been with us in excess of 5 years. So we've got a combination of PhDs, masters. Myself is a master's. I've got an MBA from here at U of C. We have a strong group who've been with us around and been there. Again, we've all been there and done it. Where we need to grow and where we need to get potential support is in expanding in research, commercialization, and more development team members. In terms of development, we're 50% ready with our ATS, our applicant tracking, 85 with our parsing technologies. We're looking at big data analysis, and there, again, is no one doing that in this realm. That's front-end, what I call front-end big data analysis, from bringing in the applicant at the development stage or at the apply stage. And that is a huge area for us, and we're spending some strong time at that. That will be NRC funded. So the capital, what we're looking for is $500,000, 20% of the company. And that, of course, will be used to hire additional research, sales, and development team. So any questions?
Does your solution offer an API?
Yes, certainly.
In your slides, you mentioned at least 5 very large businesses with much higher financial resources and resources overall. What do you think is your differentiating factor in this very competitive and crowded space against some big names?
New technology. So what exists now is older user interfaces, bad software, I guess, is in essence the best descriptor. And those just cannot stay the way they are. Typically, we're getting feedback from users that are migrating from bad software to our system is they hate it. They just hate it. And that's going to be the teller. Okay.
So the concept with parsing software is interesting to me, but I can't believe that somebody out there isn't doing some parsing of text.
Actually, IBM's Watson program is doing that, but they're doing it at the back end. So they're doing it behind the scenes, and they're not doing, and they're working with mostly performance management. And they haven't really gone all the way with it. It's not an easy technology to master. So there's really no one doing it outside of what I call the door.
Okay?
If that makes sense.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Up next we have Borealis. Allison will be pitching.
And we're live. So I'm Craig Dunn. I'm a recovering oil and gas geologist. It's been 7 years renewable, and I'm doing okay. So first off, how many of you guys are even familiar with the concept of geothermal energy? Oh, that's more than most, so that's great news. Normally I give this presentation and nobody knows that I'm not putting in heat pumps, so we're gonna start with there. I have an opportunity that I've been working on for a very long time. I work in the geothermal energy sector. It's all about earth heat. Now, when we say geothermal, most of us think volcanoes and heat flow and lava. And for me, I think the biggest issue I'm trying to get around for people from an education perspective is that our planet is a giant heat battery. It is more energy than we will ever possibly use. The joke is that the sun will burn out before we run out of Earth heat. Now, when we talk about renewable energy, most of us think wind and solar, but we're forgetting that a huge chunk of our carbon taxable energy is from things like natural gas on the heating side. And so what we've moved forward with in the geothermal energy development is to understand, how do you monetize heat? What is the best possible ways of making an amazing heat resource into a cash flow environment? And the short answer to this is food. And how many things can you make with heat for food? Pretty much everything. And that's one of the best parts. So when we started this project, we were looking at an electricity development. We were looking at selling power to BC Hydro at one of Canada's top geothermal energy areas. This town is a beautiful town called Valemont. How many people have been to Valemont? Oh, yeah, well, she works for me. That doesn't count. This is probably one of the prettiest towns in all of Canada. It's about an hour west of Jasper, and it is sitting along something that we call the Rocky Mountain Trench. Geologically, it's probably pretty boring. It's the edge of a former craton, but in reality, it's the heat resource that gives us both Fairmont and the Radium Hot Springs. It extends hundreds of kilometers, and right here, this little hot spring here, is actually one of the hottest hot springs in Canada. So geologically, this is, for me, as an exploration geologist, this is money. This is an incredible resource. We're thinking that we could develop power structures that look, in comparison to places like California, Oregon, Nevada, places that have already developed a power structure. But what we found is that the community was loving the idea of using their heat resource for something else. So when things started to slowly change in our industry, we're seeing things like the Paris and oil pricing. We have two new elections in the last year that I can't get my head around. But what we're actually looking at is that our little geothermal project, while all this was happening, slowly got more and more exposure. People are like, hey, that heat thing, tell me about that, Craig. And this was a great opportunity, to the point where people are starting to approach us and saying, hey, can you do a fish farm like that one in Oregon? Can I grow shrimp and make it organic and get Vancouver Aquarium to approve of this stuff? I'm like, well, absolutely. So we had customers that are coming to us, and with that, the community support. Now, why am I so giddy about this geothermal resource? Because when I worked in heavy oil, and I worked in the Bakken, and I worked in all these other plays, I was always chasing a resource that would always run out. No matter how good I was, that reservoir was going to run out. So when I look at a place like this, where the earth heat resource is incredibly long-term, it is baseload renewable energy. So the idea of baseload means that you turn your lights on, those lights go on. And they go on when it's sunny, and when it's winds blowing, and when it's night, and when it's cold outside, because our planet is acting as that energy battery. So in the last decade, I've spent a good chunk of my career getting really good at finding heat. And this one was a no-brainer. This is actually taken a month ago, I think illegally. Oops. They're not actually supposed to dig a hole where they are swimming in close to 50-degree water at surface. To get 50-degree water where I'm standing, I'm going to drill almost 2 kilometers. This is happening right at surface, and my permit area starts right there. This resource is an incredible opportunity for exploration. So, great heat resource, that's great, Craig, but how do I turn that into cash? How do I turn that into sellable tomatoes? So the answer is that we're looking at bringing on, and we've already started this, of developing a heat park in this 250-acre area. We have about 50 acres that the Valemont Community Forest is working with us to actually provide heat to a number of greenhouse, aquaculture, ecotourism destinations, even educational facilities. We've already signed on a number of parties to help us develop this eco park. Now, the short answer is this, Craig, you don't know anything about greenhouses, do you? That's not true. I love what they make. I love the food that comes out of them. But the answer is, I'm a heat expert. So what I did is, we created with Borealis is an opportunity for those customers to buy heat off us at a discount to natural gas. Who are these guys? Well, I'd like to say that we thought of this idea of a geoheat park ourselves, but really, at the end of the day, we actually stole this idea from some of the best in the world. This project on the bottom is in the UK. It's the Eden Project. This one, the Haku Farm in New Zealand, they get people to actually fish for shrimp as a tourist destination where they serve it to you. It's all heated off the back of a geothermal power plant in New Zealand. And then this last one, we're looking at industrial grade applications. So we've already signed up a great deal of the customer base. We're very excited about that. And then the future sales is dictated on a very, very small scale. So our development is actually a heat project that is small enough that we're going to be using about a tenth of our geothermal resource from one well. When we start to develop the larger project, the scale of this gets pretty dramatic. I'm going to keep this slide short because all of our local fossil fuels, this is a funny concept. It's $2 a gigajoule to buy natural gas, but to get it to your house, it's closer to 9 to 10. People don't get this. $2 a gigajoule, Craig, you'll never beat that. That's true, I won't. But if you're going to sit next to the natural gas plant, sure, that's a good deal. But the point is we can beat this by up to 20%. And the longer our projects go, we're hoping to sign 10 and 20-year heat contracts. We can't know the price of oil next week. But I can tell a client who's growing tomatoes that I'm going to give you your heat price for the next 15 to 20 years. The structure of those deals are very, very exciting for our customer base. And I'm not even going to get into this. There's a few engineers who know that this is just a bad idea. When you convert electricity back into heat, the efficiency tanks. So I'm not even going to compete with those guys. This is one of my favorite slides because I get to tell everyone that Allison, give a little wave, just got appointed to the Alberta Innovates Super Board. So if you guys are all finished that, guys across the thing, they merged all the ones and they decided that Allison, who's one of our principals, is qualified enough in this tech space slash energy development to actually be one of the leaders for Alberta in innovation. I've been at this a very long time. Anders is another one. Our board of directors is off the charts. We have guys like Dr. Alan Jessup, who actually ran the geothermal energy department in 1982. He wrote more reports on this type of resource development before I was even born. And then we have a number of others that if you're more than happy to go through. I think the important part is not what I'm telling you about ourselves. It's the fact that we've already gotten SDTC funding. We've already received IRAP funding. We've already received a number of international firsts. Specifically, one of the very first companies, or the very first company, to win a permit for geothermal in the Northwest Territories. At the end of the day, this is about $1.5 million project. This is just one project. When we start to move forward, you know, 10, 20-year contracts, what we're actually looking at is that when we start to develop the power project to this, this thing expands dramatically. So again, we're using a small percentage of the heat from the reservoir. As we start to develop the power project, then we move it even further. This is just one. We also own a permit in Terrace, BC. And then the last part of this is that I worked in the oil patch a long time. There's over 500,000 wells across the Western Canadian Basin. Do you know what we use the heat for? Nothing. Every once in a while, there's a co-produced fluids project, but using waste heat from the oil patch to make renewable energy, we are currently building that model at Canoe Reach so that we can expand that model throughout the entire Western Canadian market. So your cherries from tomato could be literally grown in Medicine Hat. The structure of this company, talk about skin in the game. We're a privately held company. We paid our bills doing exploration and consulting for other companies in Canada and globally. But what it allowed us to do is to bootstrap our own projects. So if you want to talk about, you know, am I invested in this? Just ask my wife. The short answer to this, we have two drill-ready projects. And with a little bit more policy change that we're seeing coming down the pipe, both federally and provincially, thanks to some of the work from the Canadian Geothermal Energy Association, we're about to see this geothermal market crack wide open. The ask is pretty simple. Our project design is about $5.5 million for Vailmont. We've already put in about $1.4 million, I think, to date. We're looking at other locations. I'm quite happy, Allison has led this one as well, is that we are hopefully going forward with our CDUPS campaign in the next month. We'll be one of the only brick and mortar style operations in the energy sector, and specifically in renewable on that campaign. So there's our ATB. You're welcome, Sandy. That should get a vote, shouldn't it? Devastating. The goal for us is to finish out our exploration. We have a few more spots that we want to triple check, but then moving right into the slim hole program, which gives us our heat resource. This is the best part. Does anyone know why this is relevant in today's drilling market? Yeah, we're at like 82% sit rate. So the drilling rigs that I would use to drill this, this economic model changed dramatically in the last 18 months. I'm happy to say that our drilling costs have come down anywhere from 40 to 70%, depending on what we're looking at. So yeah, time to drill. At the end of the day, I am pitching that you guys invest in renewable energy development and better food, food you can eat rather than ship. So please support Borealis, and thanks for your time.
Thank you, Pat.
Oh, I have to answer questions.
Maybe it's a silly question. How do you transfer heat?
Yeah, very good question. The well design, we actually transfer heat each and every day in the oil patch. The short answer is water. So our formation is not only hot, geologically I need a formation that is hot and fractured or permeable. So what happens is I re-inject the cold water down, it permeates through that reservoir, and then it propagates back up. The advantage is that if I do it correctly, I can actually get that system to run indefinitely. And that's a whole lot of geophysics and reservoir modeling. But at the end of the day, it's the water that acts as a medium for heat transfer. Unless somebody in the room, tech guy, has a graphene. Nobody's got a graphene background? Okay. Thermal, ballistic.
So it becomes a closed system. You don't have to add water every single time, find a water source.
We get that question a lot. Is it's actually a lot of water that moves through that system, but all the water does is acts as a transfer. And then across the utility itself, it would have a direct heat transfer, which allows us to use a very, very benign water through the loop to feed all of our customer base. The disadvantage to geothermal is I can't ship it like tens of kilometers, so I have to make sure that my customer base is right there, which is what we've done with the heat park.
What sort of structure do your heat contracts look like with people? Are they structured as options to buy heat or?
They're structured as an agreement to buy X number of gigajoules per year. It's a thermal contract, and then anything over that minimum value gets you a price point. Anything below gets you another price point. And we also have a contract agreement that we're working on that allows us to be able to higher quality heat. So if somebody, the brewery, for instance, that wants 90 or 120 degree heat, they'll pay a slightly different price than the guy who's keeping tree seedlings warm. Right? So that allows us to maximize our resource potential, or sellability, I guess. Cascading, as it's called in the industry. A few engineers.
Thank you so much.
That was easy.
Good job.
Thank you. Thanks. So up next, we have TicTix. And the presenter is actually Andrew Brown. And funny enough, the first year we came to Calgary, Andrew was part of the organization, like the organizing team of the Funding Roadshow, and now he's pitching. So best of luck to him. And great to see you again.
Silence among the crowd. Hi, everyone. My name is Andrew. I'm the co-founder and CEO of a company called TicTix. Our team is creating a better way for buyers, sellers, and fans like myself to distribute, buy, and sell tickets amongst each other, sports fans specifically. The problem we're trying to solve is that 35% of all individual season ticket holder tickets don't get used by that season ticket holder. 40% of all box and corporate tickets go unused altogether. The secondary market that supports those tickets on the resale market has an average markup of 38% from the listing price of that ticket. That means this person bought the ticket, relisted it, and the secondary market marks it up by 38%. The secondary market, as of today, is unregulated, monopolized in some ways with big tickets, scalping broker platforms like StubHub and SeatGeek and Vivid Seats. It's segmented in a lot of ways with a lot of startups and younger companies like ourselves coming into the market. Those providers provide a poor digital infrastructure for the market demands, with millennials like myself coming up and expecting to be able to buy, sell, and distribute tickets from my phone. Most importantly, the price of these tickets in the secondary market is not controlled by the person that creates the value behind them. Where does all this money go? 50% of all tickets sold on the primary market get resold or switch hands at least one time before they actually get used at a venue. The secondary ticket market, digital specific, was projected to be $2 billion back in 2008. And as of 2014, it's projected to be $6 billion with a 20% year-over-year growth rate for the next 5 years. This market's taking off and it's due for disruption. So what we did was build a mobile commerce platform that allowed seamless digital transactions between season ticket holders, the teams themselves, and potential buyers like me. Proof of concept. This is a little bit about our story. So last April, we launched our first beta product to the Calgary Flames market when the Flames made the playoffs, much to most of our surprise. What we were trying to prove was that if we could provide a platform where sellers could post tickets for free and that we notified buyers that they were available, that they would pay a small transaction fee to purchase them, all from within one mobile app. What we saw when we first launched in April was 1,000 people download the app within 5 home playoff games. We then went on to build an Android version of the product, which we relaunched in October, and have since seen 15% month-over-month growth, 31% of our users are monthly active, and less than $1.50 customer acquisition fee per customer. We now have over 2,700 users that use our product on a daily basis, or sorry, on a monthly basis. Not only that, they're happy to tell their friends and brag for us. We have a 4.9 rating on the Google Play Store. We also have a 5-star rating on the Apple Store. All sorts of great comments about how great this is to use, and this is what they were looking for the whole time. So what do we do from here? We're currently in the process of rebuilding our platform to make it more user-friendly and more interactive for users within the app. We're also building out a white label platform that we can actually sell and license to teams so they can control their own secondary market and all the data that's gathered within the time that a ticket's sold primarily to the time it actually gets used at the venue, creating value every step of the way. Our go-to-market strategy is to leverage existing communities that already exist, just like we did for our initial launch with the Facebook group of over 5,000 members. We plan on licensing and white labeling the product to the Flames, Oilers, who have already shown interest. The LA Dodgers have an accelerator program that they called us down to talk to them for last week, and we're really interested in what we're doing, as well as exploring emerging markets. So for the $6 billion industry that I talked about, there's a whole subsidiary market of emerging markets like NCAA, junior amateur sports, festivals, international sporting events, the Olympics, everything else that struggles with this same problem. Our current business model sees 100% of our revenue coming from transactional fees. What we see this changing moving forward is by year 3, we plan on 1/3 of our revenue coming from transactional fees, 1/3 coming from white label and SaaS revenue, and 1/3 coming from the data that we gather along the way and sell back to the teams. This is where we are now. So year 1, we've brought in a small amount of founders and friends and family money. Year 2, we've brought on a little bit more angel and growth money, which we're using to develop a platform that we can get into a profitable state with. And by 2017, we plan on bringing in additional funding so that we can actually grow and scale. So to date, we've raised $200,000 in grant money, friends and family, and founders money. Today, we're here asking for $500,000 in seed capital to help take us to the next step. And in 2017 or later, we foresee bringing on $1 to $5 million in growth capital to really take it to the next level. This near-term spend for that $500,000 is going to be spent on business partnership development. We also want to recruit an industry expert to bring on board the team. Programming support for our current build, as well as marketing and operations of our current product. We're here with the right team, the right product, at the right time to disrupt a $6 billion industry and growing, and we're here to ask for your help to get us there. Thank you.
I seem to be going first every time. What's the what do the owners of the tickets actually think about the secondary market? Because I know they're trying to be cracking down on it as much as they can, especially when you put yourself out there. The scalper and at the gallery at the outside of the stadium is not somebody they're going to go after, right?
Yeah. So which stakeholder? The actual ticket holder?
The owner of the team.
Franchise.
They love it. They know that there's a huge, about 1/3 of their secondary market they don't have access to data and analytics behind. I spoke to the Flames senior operations manager the other day, validated our assumptions that there is a big problem that they're trying to deal with and trying to figure out how to deal with it. Their biggest concern is really how this fits in their current technology stack that they already use, which we've talked to them about, basically a way to position ourselves and provide a layer on top that's more fan-to-fan interaction. Based.
Hey, Andrew. I like your slides, nice and simple and clear and clean. My question would be on the, you're saying 38% tickets unused and I think 40% of the boxes and whatnot, but aren't they really not, like they're unused in terms of tracking, but they were already sort of promised to somebody, weren't they? Like someone said, I got these tickets, it's whether they showed up or not. So they weren't really available to resell. Out of that 40%, I'm guessing, because I've had those tickets given to me, so yeah. They're not available to resell, and maybe I went and maybe I didn't, but I thought I was going to go.
This number for box and corporate tickets is really a limitation that the team puts on it, specifically because they don't want those to end up on StubHub and other secondary platforms that are scalper and broker driven. So what they said to us is we'd love to find a better way to get these from one person's hands to another, generate more people in attendance for the actual stadium, which equals more revenue for them, but also grab the data about who's actually coming and using these tickets. So this 40% for corporate and box tickets is more specific to a limitation that's put on by the teams right now because they can't control the price. They can't set a price floor or ceiling on those tickets once they hit the secondary market.
What sort of data do the team owners think might be valuable out of your platform?
Customer demographics and dynamic pricing of the tickets. So when the ticket is sold at the very beginning of the year, it's sold at what's best guess of how much that ticket is worth. Leading up to the game, it changes many, many times based on who's on the ice, field, pitch, whatever you want to call it, day of the week that it is, and weather's a big factor down in the States and other outdoor stadiums are all factors that change the price of the ticket leading up to game time. Once the puck or kickoff, I get confused, I'm a hockey fan. Once the puck's dropped, the price changes as well because obviously you're seeing less of the game. So two things there, customer demographics, who's actually using these tickets and coming to the stadium to use them. And the second one is the price of the ticket leading up and how does that change and how can they take advantage of that.
Are these digital tickets?
We're focused 100% on digital. We know that we're giving up hard copy tickets that are currently on the market right now. There is technology that we can use to actually convert a hard copy to a digital. We'd rather stay away from that and focus on digital.
So I don't know, but is the elephant in the room Ticketmaster?
To some degree, yes. But what they're trying to do in order to take advantage of this shift in the market as well is open up their data and API and SDKs that are available to us. So as a startup, they're now offering their data as a license agreement for especially early adapters like ourselves that can create more engaging experiences for the fans that actually buy tickets. Ticketmaster has a lot of problems. They often try to solve these problems first and then realize that they're a slow-moving machine that can't do it and will often try to find a partner that wants to work on that specific problem.
So and one follow-on, you mentioned sports fundamentally, but are you looking at movies or anything else, entertainment venues?
Yeah, music and live events are definitely down in kind of a pipeline dream. We want to focus on sports right now to focus our attention on one industry, and to be honest, the where we see the biggest problem and the biggest opportunity for us to create value.
Stampede
would be nice too.
Again, what is the question that I've asked earlier to other presenters, what is your exit strategy here?
Yeah, a lot of different liquidation opportunities. I think the biggest one is a merger acquisition. Ticketmaster scooped up a ton of these types of companies over the last couple of years. Our goal is really to build a healthy and profitable business that we can either blow past our competition or be in a position where we could be acquired.
We're going to take one question from the crowd.
It's just a how question. You need the ticket issuing partner to authenticate the ticket. How does that part work?
That's what we've done up until this point, although our MVP product, we actually manually validated the ticket to make sure that it was legitimate. One of the biggest things for buyers is they want to know that they don't get fraudulent tickets in their hands. That's a big pain point on their side. We can solve that problem, especially with the transition that Ticketmaster is doing right now with opening up their data for us to use. That's something that's been really recent. In fact, I think 2 weeks ago they actually announced that this is going to be available for us. We've opened up a conversation with them and expect to be able to get access to it. That's how we validate the tickets.
Any other question? One last question.
It's on a convertible note right now. Details, we've put together a 6% interest rate, $2 million market cap, which we expect to blow past in the next couple of years.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Andrew. Congrats. You're still thinking you're part of the organizing team, huh? Walking away with our stuff. Well, it was a great set of pitches. We're just going to compile all of the judges' grades and announce the official Fundica Roadshow for the Innovate Calgary 2016. But before we do that, we're actually going to let you guys vote for your
favorite pitch. So does everyone have a phone on them today? I'm pretty sure. I've seen all of you guys text, okay? So we're going to set up the SMS poll. We'll just get all of the pitching companies to come out in the order that they've pitched today, just for 1 minute, and briefly say again what they work on, what their solution is, and then we'll get all of the audience to actually vote for you guys. So I'm going to steal this from you. Yeah, so if I could get SpectraLog out. Then Physio4D, Super Major, People, Goes Around, Hoblet, Keywave, Pay, Higher Ground, Borealis, and then TickTix in order, please.
Hi, I'm Grant Sandin, CEO of SpectraLog. Our company's main business is to use the analytics of light to improve the way the world produces its resources. So we currently have Super Major clients and customers, and we're applying a new technology to give high-resolution insight into resource management and resource production in agriculture, oil and gas, and mining and minerals. Thank you.
Did you know that 70% of the patient population are not compliant with the recommendations of their physiotherapist? In Physio4D, we try to increase patients' compliance by a mobile app that patients can download their exercises into their mobile and view them from different angles and also with different visualizations. And we also scan their body such that they can be corrected how to do the exercises correctly using our computer vision algorithm. And also underneath of that, we gather biometric data from their exercises. And in terms of charts and diagrams, we report them to their physiotherapists to keep track of their compliance and provide an evidence-based assessment of the success of their treatment. And also with gamification of the exercises, we try to engage patients with their exercise rehab program and ultimately improve the patient care.
What if there was a place where you could go to find out who someone really is? Where you can look up that new employee that you're about to hire, where you can see if that babysitter is really good, or maybe who that person is that you just met online. People is an app that allows you to be recommended professionally, personally, and romantically by the people you know. People is a safe place for you to manage your online reputation while making better decisions about the people around you. With our app, you can take all of the amazing recommendations you receive as a business owner or an employee or somebody who volunteers and share them onto social media. You can share them through Facebook, Twitter. You can share them with anybody who's outside the app over text and email. You can use our nearby feature to find out who's in this very room and why you should connect with them to get more of what you want. People is going to take your character and allow you to turn it into a new form of social currency. Thank you.
Have you ever wished it was easier to find a way to make a difference in the world? If you worked for a charity or a school, did you wish it was easier to find the help you need when you need it? Or if you own a business, would you like to make a dollar and a difference and understand who you helped and how much? 2,600 people and 280 charities so far have answered yes to that question by joining Goes Around, a social network to allow individuals, businesses, and nonprofits find, measure, and share their social impact activities. We look forward to encouraging a growing community of people who basically give a damn to do more and make the better world a better place, one good deed at a time.
Hello. Hi, I'm Sam from Hoblet. I got two questions for you guys. Who here has ever looked, who has ever typed into Google things to do in Calgary? Show of hands. There we go. Who here thinks the reason why you're doing that is because you don't know what you want to do? Hoblet.com has all those experiences for you. Thank you.
Keywave is developing a wearable that is placed in your ear, like Fitbit for your ear, but with much more capabilities. Our patent-pending design merges wireless headphone technology with 15 microsensors working together with a software app. But KeyWave's hearable goes far beyond hunting applications to the headphone market, where our wireless Bluetooth headphone calibrates to your particular hearing characteristics to give you the absolute perfect sound. To the firefighting market, where the chief can actually remotely monitor the location of his men, their body vitals, and even the air quality. With our team of specialists in nanotechnology and audio specialists from George Lucas's THX team, we're underway to making this reality. Thank you.
Hi. My name's Henry Tenby. I'm a co-founder with Pay. The number one problem in the payments industry is fraud, and it costs the industry, it costs people like you that own small businesses and banks, it costs everybody $16 billion a year. And the solution is Pay. Pay is a Canadian registered money service business, and we have developed the world's first all-in-one global e-payment system that is high security focused. The benefit for you as a business owner is that by providing high security, we can lock your accounts down and we can provide reduced fraud in our system, which means lower fees to you, for you and your business. And we also operate in over 60 countries. We can process payments in over 60 countries. So we're looking to raise $250,000 to facilitate our adding credit cards to our system and our expansion into the U.S. market. That's it. Thank you very much.
So I'm Marilyn from Higher Ground. So I just wanted to say that we've been around since 1999. We've been there, done it, not only once, but three times now. So we've got the expertise, the experience, the staff, the client base, the revenue model, all kind of there for us. And now it's just a matter of being able to take that forward and growing it. We have a product that we believe is a strong addition to our core, which is that parsing technology that I mentioned and described earlier. And we believe that's going to be a real strength moving forward with our system and our applicant tracking system. So we're just looking forward to taking that to bigger and better and growing our business. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Craig Dunn with Borealis Geopower. Best advice that I've ever got for investing was invest in things that people need. Lights, heat, food. These seems like a no-brainer to me, is that this is the type of investment that we want to be thinking of for the next generation. I'm talking about pitching clean energy. I'm talking about investing in food when our skyrocketing food bill is going up. I'm talking investing in 10 and 20 year heat contracts when we can't predict the price of fossil fuels next week. I have a power project with a heat opportunity that is absolutely incredible, provided to us by Mother Earth. This is an opportunity that comes with the community support, First Nations support. We have an active permit, and we've done some incredible exploration to identify this resource. So I'm asking you today to invest in the next generation of energy.
Hey folks, my name is Andrew. I'm co-founder and CEO of TickTix. The secondary sport ticket market is broken. Scalpers and brokers are the ones benefiting, and teams, venues, and fans like us are the ones losing. I'm here to ask for $500,000 for your help and help our team that's in the right place at the right time to disrupt a $6 billion industry. If you're interested, come talk to me after.
So the number to text your choice to, so every single company has, you need to text that number, and the cell phone number that you're going to send this to is 58, so let me know, is everyone ready? So pick your winner, put in the message box. You can tell your friends and family to also vote for you. That's a catch. And the number to text it to is 587. Judges, you can vote as well. 587-409-6630. So 587-409-6630. All right, votes are coming in. SMS poll net.
Is one of your pitching companies on
it? No. I saw it at another event. It was cool. All right, just a few more seconds. Come on, you guys need to break the tie here. So 587-409-6630. 587-409-6630. Congratulations, Tic Tics. Come out. We're going to snap you here if you want to say a few words.
I'd like to thank my friends and family. I'd like to thank all you guys for voting. I wasn't prepared to give this speech. Thank you for your time and for being here. We really appreciate the opportunity from Fundica and Innovate Calgary for hosting and everything else. And we hope to see good things to come for our team at Tic Tics in years to come. Thank you.
All right. So we're currently compiling the official grades of the panel, and we'll be announcing the winner in 5 minutes. So stay tuned and stay around. Winner is Keywave. Congratulations. This is your unofficial ticket to the Valley. Unofficial ticket. If you want, if you can step out of the light, though, so we can take fabulous pictures of you. Any words for aspiring entrepreneurs or anything you'd like to tell us?
Well, I'm feeling very speechless at this moment. I don't actually quite know how to express my excitement for these results. Thank you, guys. A word of advice for inspiring entrepreneurs: hard work, dedication, and passion, I guess in three, is really what I live by, right? If you have passion for what you do, you know, when the days get tough, which they always do, there's one thing I've always learned is that entrepreneurship, it has the most roller coaster of a ride. You go through the highest highs you've ever had, like right now I'm going through, but also the absolute lowest lows where you just fear, you know, and that's where a lot of people, they decide to drop out. But if you have true passion in it, it will see you through it and you'll see the next high. So thank you, everyone. I'll probably go see sun first, see some the beach. But other than that, yeah, I'd love to get in touch with a lot of the venture capitalists out there and just all the technology and software guys. And I have no idea. I'm just...
Thank you all for coming out today. I hope you enjoyed the day, and see you all very, see you all soon. And keep up with us at hashtag Fundica Roadshow. Sign up for perks if you haven't done so to leverage those great offers that our national partners have to give you guys at fundicaroadshow.com/perks. And if you have any questions, you know, feel free to reach out anytime. And I hope you guys, even for people that are raising funding before you guys go to angel or equity or VC, you know, money, go on Fundica and leverage this great tool. Thanks, and have a great day.